love to hear. That you do for us. Lord, help us. God, in the life you give us, Lord, God, it's never a smooth path. There's always some kind of something to stumble over or stub your toe on or something. And I pray you help us all, God. And Lord, give us something tonight that'll, God, help us along the way. And when the rough times come and these problems come that we need to deal with, I pray you just... give us something that we can use, Lord, to help smooth the way. Help us now as we praise and hear your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, brothers, pretty well the same announcements we had this morning, so come give us some.
All right, let's turn over our hymnals to hymn number 213. Hymn number 213, I've heard of a land on a faraway strand.
Jesus on fire, every day.
Well, before we start with our sermon this evening, I would like to report a little bit. I went by to see Uncle Charlie this afternoon at his house to see how he was. He's not doing so good, folks. Pray for him. He showed me his legs, and my wife had the same problem. It's what they call edema. It's a gathering of fluid on your joints, and his upper legs are swollen probably three times the size they should ought to be, and his knees are almost like basketballs, one of them. So pray for him. He let me in. I thought he was going to hit the floor right then and there, but I just told him to take his time, and we went and we sat and we had a good long talk, and we had a good long time of prayer. And he loves y'all, and he wants me to tell you that. And he misses you being here. So pray for him. So he just keep him in your prayers. I don't see how he makes it. He's got two little doggies, and you know how little doggies are. They like to get between your legs. I can see how some of the things happen. His wife said howdy. She's indeed in the bed. So there's people that come, hospice people. I don't know if they would come every day. I would hope so. To tell you the truth, he could use something like that. But whether he's ever take it. Uncle Charlie comes from a great generation of people. These are the people that kind of came right after World War II. And they were strong people. My dad was a part of this generation of people. And my mom was. And they were tough people. And they made it through bad, bad, bad times. And I tell you the truth, they didn't take much help because they had been through so many bad times. They figured they could handle it. And the trouble is they get aged. Sometimes they need help, and they don't realize they need help. So just pray for his family and his little doggies. They like Brother Jeff. I had him in my lap petting on him while I was talking to him the whole time. So. I don't know whether they smelled the cat on me or they just said, "Oh boy, come in here," or what. But we had a good time. So I urge you to pray for him. Turn to Philippians chapter number 1. And we're going to study a little thing. To understand the idea I'm trying to get across is I want you to think of the most beautiful symphony, orchestra, or band thing you've ever heard in your life, and remember how great it was, and you know how the conductor got up there and he led everybody and they all played in the, you know, the way they were supposed to play and everything, and man, when they were over, everybody, oh, what a great time, they clapped, you know, and it's all great when everything goes along, everybody plays the notes they're supposed to play. But then I don't know if you've ever been to something where somebody didn't play a good note somewhere along the line, and everybody kind of looking around like, ooh, that was a bad note. You know what we call that music? We call that a sour note. It's a note. Oh, yes, it's a note. Oh, yes, it was played with the instrument. Oh, yeah, the fellow who played it is normally a good player, but for some reason, that note he played, it didn't belong there. And it kind of threw the whole thing off. And that's sort of what, tonight I'm going to preach on the sour note in the harmony. Philippians chapter 1, verse 12. But I would ye should understand, brethren, that the things which happened unto me have fallen out rather unto the furtherance of the gospel. Now, at this point in Paul's career, he's sitting in a Roman jail somewhere, okay? He said, that my bonds in Christ are manifest in all the palace and in all other places. In other words, everybody everywhere knows that this crazy guy named Paul is going around bugging everybody, preaching to him. He's landed up in the Roman jail there in Rome. Everybody knows about it. And many of the brethren in the Lord, waxing confident by my bonds, are much more bold to speak the word without fear. Well, okay, that in and of itself is not a bad thing. It's like, okay, our guy Paul's in jail and he's not going to be coming around for a while now because he is in jail. He might get thrown to the lions tomorrow, so we better pick up the pace and do some preaching. That in and of itself ain't a bad thing. If Brother Bill, Brother Bill did. He dropped dead and I took over. If I drop dead tomorrow, I have no doubt somebody here will get up in the pulpit and say something and help feed the congregation until y'all get a regular pastor. And I have no doubt of that. So that in and of itself is not a bad thing. But then there's this next verse. The one preach Christ. Oh, there's always one, isn't there? The one preach Christ of contention, not sincerely supposing to add affliction to my bond. There's the sour note guy. There's one guy in the church that says, okay, I'm gonna get it, but I'm going to fix old Paul. I'm going to get it where everybody hates old Paul. And it doesn't say what he preached or how he preached or what. But he's not preaching out of the heart of love or to help people or teach people or do anything else but cause trouble for Paul. It's a sour note in the harmony. But the other love, knowing that I'm set for the defense of the gospel. Heavenly Father, help us now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Chords in music are a wonderful thing. You've got major chords. You've got minor chords. You've got sustained chords. I got this little book at home of guitar chords. And to tell you the truth, it just tells you the technical title of the chord and shows you how to play the guitar. And most of that book, I don't know what in the heck they're talking about. It's like, what in the world is a D sustained minor, you know, with a major fifth, hanging on a corner, I look at that like, huh? And I try to play it and say, well, I ain't playing that one anytime soon, But supposedly, when you play a chord, it all kind of goes together. And sometimes it can be a minor chord, sometimes it can be a major chord. But with any kind of chord, you can always throw in a note that don't go there. And not only don't it go there, but everybody listening to that chord say, hey, there's something wrong with that chord. Now, I realize there are types of music like jazz and different things that probably rock and roll and things where they throw in these weird chords and they make these sour notes on purpose. But most of the people, when they hear a sour note, say, ugh, you didn't play that right. And, we're a chord, the church is. We're supposed to get along together. We're supposed to make beautiful music for the Lord. And when people come into the church, or even people sitting in the church, and there's disharmony in the church, usually people say, ooh, that's not so good. I don't want ever that to happen to our church. I've seen it hurt people badly when that kind of stuff happens. I don't ever want to see a Christian ever get hurt in this church. Unless the Lord does something to them. And then it's out of my hands. But I personally, I don't ever make a sermon think, oh, I'm going to get him and say a mess. I don't ever think of that. I just go to the Lord and say, what do you want me to preach, Lord? And he gives me something, I come up and I preach it. And I try my best to give you something that's edifying and be a blessing. Well, there's a couple things we need to find out about this sour note. First of all, I want to say that Paul couldn't be there when all his preaching went on. He couldn't be there. Why? He's in jail. you know, sometimes you just can't be there when you want to be there. And you know, them Roman soldiers, they weren't the most understanding people in the world, you know. They stuck you in that hole in the ground, and it was a lot of them were. You know, maybe if someone came and fed you, that would be okay. And if they didn't, well, that was okay too. Lucky Paul had a lot of friends, even in Rome. And I guess they would come by every day and bring him something to eat. You say, well, didn't they feed you in jails in the Roman times? No, no, they didn't. No, no. It was up to your family or friends to feed you. What was interesting about this is, and it makes it a strange story, but Paul was actually forewarned that he was going to get in this situation. In Acts chapter 20, if you want to turn there, verse 23, it talks about him. He's going back to Jerusalem before he gets arrested in Jerusalem. And he says something very peculiar to the Ephesians. He's saying goodbye to the Ephesians. And he says in verse 23, say that the Holy Ghost witnesseth in every city, saying that bonds and afflictions abide me. You realize the gravity of that verse? He's saying, look, every town and little village I've passed through going on this trip back to Jerusalem, the Holy Spirit has made sure to tell me that if I do what I'm fixing to do, I'm going to get arrested and get stuck in jail. You say, did Paul get out of the will of God? Yes. Did God use him anyway? Yes. We wouldn't have the book of Philippians if Paul hadn't been in jail there to write it. Or if we'd had it, it'd have been a different book. So, sometimes even when we get out of the will of God, God can still use us. But I'm not recommending it. I mean, it's no fun. He had to be dragged, you know, to this court and that court, and then he got stuck on a ship and had a shipwreck, and you know, he got bit by a snake, and yeah, I mean, you read the book of Acts, and then he finally gets to Rome, you know, and people still make fun of it. There's a verse where it says they saw the three taverns. When you go into the old city of Rome, there was three taverns. Now, a tavern to us is a beer joint, but back in those days, I guess it was probably a wine joint, but it was also an inn where you went into the tavern and you could get a place to sleep for the night. So it was like, you know, it was like saying there was $3. But I've heard people say, looky there, you know, Paul was glad when he saw the booze joint. No, that's not why he was glad. He was glad because they had reached some civilization and he figured he wasn't going to be bit by no more snakes and, you know, thrown into the sea and all the stuff. It's quite an adventure to read all that stuff. But one of the things that he said to the Ephesians when he said goodbye to them before he left to go to Jerusalem, said, the Holy Ghost told me, I go there, I'm going to get in jail. Sure enough, he got in jail. I looked this thing up about Roman jails. But you know what I found? It didn't have any Wikipedia pages. It said, see Roman slavery. Because basically, if they put you in a Roman jail, chances are, if you ever got out of jail, you probably got out and you were made a slave of somebody. So that's what Paul was probably looking at. It says in this Wikipedia thing, it says, all levels of employment, free working people, former slaves, and enslaved people mostly did the same kind of jobs. Elite Romans, whose wealth came with property ownership, saw little difference between slavery and a dependence on earning wage for labor. So in other words, even if they hired somebody, they considered him a slave anyway. Slaves were themselves considered property under Roman law and had no rights of legal personhood. Now, Paul got around the slavery part because he was a Roman citizen. And you could not enslave a Roman citizen. Unlike Roman citizens, by law, they could be subject to corporal punishment, exploitation of, I won't go into that, torture, summary execution. The most brutal form of punishment was reserved for slaves, The adequacy of their diet, shelter, clothing, health care was dependent on their perceived utility to the owners, whose impulse might be cruel and situationally humane. Now, some of the slaves, if they had a good owner who liked them a lot, they would treat them good. So that whole thing says, if not, they were mistreated. Under imprisonment in Rome, I found an article in an encyclopedia, and it said this. It said, imprisonment in ancient Rome was not a sentence under Roman law. Incarceration, called publica custodia, in facilities such as the Tyrannium, was intended to be a temporary measure prior to trial or execution. More extended periods of incarceration occurred, but were not official policy, condemnation to hard labor was preferred. In other words, the Romans, they would rather put you on a farm somewhere working than put you in a prison and have to feed you.
The idea there.
I can understand that. You ought to look up on Wikipedia or American Census of the United States of America how much money we spend on people that are in prisons in the United States. It's an ungodly amount of money. Mm-hmm. And you pay for that. I'm not saying you shouldn't honor, but it's a lot of money. But Paul, not only was he forewarned, but he was determined he was going to serve the Lord no matter what his situation was. In Ephesians chapter 6, verse 20, he said, "For which I am an ambassador in bonds, and that therein I may speak boldly as I ought to speak." He said, no matter whether I'm in jail or not, I'm gonna be the missionary and the preacher of Jesus. I'm going to be an ambassador. So he was preaching to all the folks in jail. I'm sure the prisoners that he was incarcerated really appreciated that. Some of them probably did. They probably would, got the guards by the sleeves. Says, can we fill this guy with the line and think he's preaching? I know some Americans that would do that. But he said he still needed their prayers. No matter what your situation is, we need each other's prayers. Colossians 4:18 says, "The salutation by the hand of me, Paul, remember my bonds, grace be with you, amen." That's the last verse in Colossians. He wanted to say, hey, don't forget me. I'm Paul, pray for me, Secondly, there were some people at the church of Philippi who were causing trouble. Now, when I started teaching this book, I said Philippi was a pretty trouble-free church, and it was. But apparently, there were a couple people that were causing problems. And they were sneaky about it. There's nothing worse than a sneaky troublemaker. Look, Paul had enough trouble with the unsaved Jews and the Romans. He did not need some brethren back at Philippi causing him trouble. I would have hated to have been that person that was preaching for the wrong reason. Wouldn't you hate to have been him? Because I'm going to tell you something. God knows everything everybody does and everything everybody says. You may ask me, well, Brother Jeff, does it bother you that we have so many empty pews? Not really. I've been in churches where I've talked to the pastor, and I could always tell because you'd arrive there Saturday afternoon, and they would spend all Saturday afternoon telling you all the problems in the church that you knew he had always had a problem. And it was never a church like this with just a handful of people. That guy had a few people, but there were a few families he wished he didn't have because they were troublemakers. And every time he turned around, they were causing him trouble. And I always tell them the same thing. I said, brother, take it to the Lord and just leave it at his feet. God knows everything that's going on, and they're going to get theirs. And a couple times I ran across these preachers at preachers' meetings and missions conferences and things, and a couple of them came up to me and said, Brother Jeff, that was good advice you gave me. I gave it to the Lord. And, you know, the very next month, God got rid of that whole family for me. God just ran the whole bunch of them out of the church. And he says, now it's so good, I can't hardly stand it. See there? He said, I really didn't need them people. I said, there you go. 2 Timothy 2:9. He said, wherein I suffer trouble as an evildoer. Now, Paul wasn't an evildoer, but he was suffering trouble like he was an evildoer. Even in the bonds, but the word of God is not bound. That's one of my favorite verses. I got a weird imagination. I think of the poor apostle Paul and all these little Bibles jumping around saying, woo, woo, let's go, ha, ha, you know, and doing their thing. You know? You say, yeah, look, this book is alive. And look, at some point, Paul was hoping that he'd be released. Okay? Hebrews 13, verse 19 says, I beseech you, the rather to do this, that I may be restored to you the sooner. And then in verse 23, know ye that our brother Timothy is set at liberty, with whom, if he comes shortly, I will see you. So apparently, at one point, Paul was arrested a couple times by the Romans. Apparently, at one point, Timothy was arrested too. And Timothy got sprung before Paul did in this particular instance. But who wants to be in jail? No matter whether it's a modern jail or a Roman jail. Because you can only do so much from jail, folks. Let's face it. Being at liberty is a better thing. Paul was asking others for help, even though some of them weren't always helpful, as this case is here. 2 Timothy 4:14 talks about another guy. And I don't know, it may have been this same fella. I don't know. They don't mention any names in Philippians till the last chapter. It says, Alexander the coppersmith did me much evil. The Lord reward him according to his works. I'd hate to have been Alexander the coppersmith. I don't know what he did, but it was bad enough Paul wrote it. You had to make Paul pretty mad for him to write your name in a bad light in his epistles. Of whom thou be aware also. So he said, be careful this guy. If he comes around, he's going to cause you trouble. For he hath greatly withstood our words. At my first answer, no man stood with me, but all men forsook me. I pray God that it may not be laid to their charge. Notwithstanding, the Lord stood with me and strengthened me, that by me the preaching might be fully known, that all the Gentiles might hear, and I was delivered out of the mouth of the lion. And the Lord shall deliver me from every evil work, and will preserve me unto his heavenly kingdom, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. God uses people in a strange way. Me and my wife used to have little tete-a-tetes about Maryland being a southern state, and I've ran across all kinds of stuff reading this book about Lincoln, and I wish he was still around and say, ha, see? But I can't do that because he's not around. But then I ran across this thing. In 1861, Lincoln was coming from Illinois by train through Baltimore into D.C. for his inauguration. And there was a plot of people that had sworn themselves to pledge to death to kill Abraham Lincoln while he was in Baltimore. And, of course, as you know, Maryland was a slave state. And there were a lot of people in Maryland that thought Maryland ought to secede from the Union. Now, their governor was named Thomas Holliday Hicks. He was a strange bird. Thomas Holliday Hicks was a Democrat. And yes, he did own slaves. He believed in slavery. Yet, he did believe in the American system. And even though he owned slaves, he did not believe Maryland ought to secede from the Union. So what could a governor do? Well, there was a call in Annapolis at the State House, where the Maryland Capitol is, to hold a special session of the Maryland Legislature to secede from the Union and to condemn Lincoln and not support him. So, old Hicks, he knew that if Maryland joined the South, that Washington, D.C. would be in a real spot. I don't know if you've looked at a map, but half the city of Washington, D.C., that's still the District of Columbia, is in Maryland. The other old city, called Alexandria now, is in Virginia, and it was part of the South. That's why they took that part of the city. And he figured it would not be good. Even though he was a slave owner, he was pro-Union. He knew that if Maryland and Virginia supposed Washington, D.C., they could effectively stop the government of the United States and disband the Union or cause it real heartache. So he said, oh, you want to meet for legislature? Okay, as governor, I have to call the legislature. Oh, by the way, I'm going to be on vacation for a few weeks, and I'll tell you when I get back. So he stalled them. Then he got back, and they were in his office saying, we want to meet. Where are we going to meet? Call a meeting. They said, well, okay. Instead of meeting in Annapolis, we're going to meet at Fredericksburg, Maryland, which is across the state. And so everybody had to pack up their duds at Annapolis, which is on the coast. And, you know, it took a couple days to get across the state back in those days. And of course, there was no railroad that went there. They had to go by carriage. And by the time they got there, Lincoln was already sworn in Washington and everything was okay. And by that time, this guy had rounded up enough support in the legislature that Maryland did not secede from the Union. This guy was a smart guy. And God used him to save the life of Abraham Lincoln. You said, how did he know about it? Well, I told you the story of Alan Pinkerton and the Pinkertons. But what I haven't told you is that the Secretary of State, Mr. Stewart, was also doing another investigation about the same thing. And Lincoln didn't believe Mr. Pinkerton when he told him of the plot. And so Lincoln was up in his hotel room in Philadelphia, and he was supposed to do some big shindig in Philadelphia after he'd done the day before. He'd been at the Independence Hall and did some kind of deal, and he was supposed to travel to Harrisburg and do another kind of dealy-do, and he was supposed to go into Baltimore by train. And Pinkerton was trying to sneak him into Washington, D.C. a little early. But Lincoln wouldn't have any of it. Well, he was sitting in his hotel room after all this shindig in Philadelphia. Came a knock at the door. Telegram, Mr. Lincoln. Opened it up. It wasn't from Mr. Pinkerton. It was Mr. Stewart. And there was an old general that had been in the War of 1812 that was part of the administration of the outgoing president. And him and Mr. Stewart had been looking into this, and he said, Mr. President, we're in the hotel lobby. We need to see you immediately. So he sat the bellboy down, and they came up to his room, and they told him the exact same thing that Alan Pinkerton had told him. And at the end of the meeting, he said, have you talked to Alan Pinkerton? And they said, who's Alan Pinkerton? And at that point, Lincoln said, oh my, this is real. And so they snuck him into Washington, D.C. aboard another train on a sleeper car. I told you about the funny story how they cramped him into a sleeper car into a bed. And that's how he came into Washington, D.C. But the danger was so real that Horace Greeley, who sat on the platform behind Abraham Lincoln, you know Horace Greeley, the same Go West young man, famous newspaper guy, he said the whole time that I sat there up on that platform, and every time Lincoln would get up and have to do something, he was scared that he was going to hear a rifle crack and that Lincoln was going to fall dead in front of him. That's how real this thing was, folks. But this guy named Hicks Had anybody ever heard of Thomas Holliday Hicks for tonight? I hadn't. I didn't know who, what clue this guy was. And he was governor of Maryland. God uses the strangest people. Mm-hmm. Say, well, God can't use me. I wouldn't put it past God to use you. God may do all kinds of marvelous things. Because I want to say this in conclusion, God's power is still working even now. Say, well, what are you talking about? Okay. The same power that saved us is the same power that holds the universe together. As far as I know, the universe is still in one piece. As far as I know, I'm still saved and you're saved if you're saved tonight. And you will be saved till you get to glory. And we'll live eternity. That's the power I'm talking about. Hebrews 1:3 says, who being the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person, and upholding all things by the word of his power. When he had by himself purged our sins, sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high. See there? It connects the holding of the universe together with your salvation. Right there in Hebrews chapter 1, verse 3. Secondly, Paul, he was able to endure the imprisonment of the Romans through the power of God. It was not fun being in a Roman prison. Like I said, they didn't feed you. They didn't ever give you a bath. You go into a modern jail and there's a... some of them have showers in the room, but there's at least a shower at the end of the cell block. And every week they're supposed to, at least once a week, go take the shower. They're allowed to go out in the yard and roam around. There's care packages. There's TVs in their cells and all kinds of things. I mean, modern prisons are pretty nice. Not in Roman times. You stayed in whatever clothes you came in. And nobody brought you new clothes. And them clothes disintegrated, you went around naked. They didn't take care of you very much. They were interested in getting you in front of the judge or the magistrate or the governor, or in this case, Nero, the Caesar, and getting you dispatched to whatever lions or slave ship or whatever your punishment was. And all that Paul endured through the power of Christ. And you can endure stuff through the power of Christ. 2 Timothy 1:8 says, be not thou therefore ashamed of the testimony of our Lord, nor of me, his prisoner, but be thou partaker of the afflictions of the gospel according to the power of God. He blames God for his being a prisoner. How do you like that? He says, I'm God's prisoner. I'm not in prison by the Romans. They can't hurt me. God's taking care of me. That's what he's saying. Look, God's power is stronger than anything you can name. The world, the flesh, the devil. Colossians 1:13 says, who hath delivered us from the power of darkness and hath translated us into the kingdom of his dear Son. Charles Spurgeon wrote this. He said, some years ago, a woman delivered a lecture in Lancashire against Christianity, in which she declared that the gospel narrative of the life of Christ is a myth. One of the mill hands who listened to her obtained permission to ask a question. You gotta look out for these little Christians that worked in the mill, but everybody kind of, he's some little dirty guy in the back of the room. He said, the question I want to ask the lady is this. 30 years ago, I was cursed to this town. And everybody shrank from me that had any respect for himself. I often tried to do better, but I could not succeed. The teetotalers got a hold of me, but I broke the pledge as often as they said. And finally, they said it was no use me trying any longer and gave up on me. Then the police got a hold of me, and I was taken before the magistrate and the wardens of the prison, trying all in vain to reform me. Then Christ took a hold of me finally and touched my heart and made me a new man. He said, now I'm an honored, respected fellow worker in the gospel and a Sunday school worker at my local church with many dear to me. And I ask, if Christ is the myth, how is it that this myth is stronger than all these other things in my life put together? Well, there's you a good question. And the lady was silent. She didn't give him an answer. And finally he said, no, miss. I should say that you can say what you will, but the gospel is the power of God and salvation. He sat down. And that lady got off the platform and left the building. What could she say to the power of God? The power of God in our lives. Oh, beloved, Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10 says, finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. One of my favorite hymns was written by Ray Palmer in the late 1800s. The music was written by Lowell Mason, called My Faith Looks Up to Thee, Thou Lamb of Calvary, Savior Divine. Now listen while I pray, take all my sin away. Oh, let me from this day be wholly thine. May thy rich grace impart strength to my fainting heart, my zeal inspire. But thou hast died for me, oh, may my love for thee pure, warm, and changeless be, a living fire. When life's dark maze I tread, and griefs around me spread, be thou my guide. Bid darkness turn today, wipe sorrow's tears away, nor let me ever stray from thee aside. When life's ends life's transient dream, when death's cold sullen stream shall o'er me roll, blessed Savior, then in love, fear and distrust remove. Oh, bear me, save above, a ransomed soul. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your faith that you give us in the righteousness that we talked about this morning. And God, sometimes we get across a sour note in our life. Problems come our way. Usually it's of human origin, and sometimes we don't know what to do to restore the harmony. But God, help us to put our trust in you as we go out into the world. Lord, thank you that we could be here in church this evening. I pray you help all those that want to be here that can't be here. There's several of them, God, and they need you, Lord. So I pray you help them physically and mentally and spiritually and every other way they need help, God. And Lord, let them know you love them. And Lord, they may not be locked in a prison somewhere, but some of them are locked in a bedroom. We can't get out, can't go nowhere, can't do anything because of health reasons. So Lord, I pray you help them. God, help us as we go. Look after us. Lord, God, you saved my life coming to church. Some car was stopped in the middle of the road, and I went around it, but the time I got just about to the front tire, I saw the ducks were crossing the road. He stopped with the ducks. I slammed on the brakes, and the car behind me, I think I scared that lady to death, Lord. But then little ducks went and crossed the road. And Lord, I guess I didn't have to do that, but God, you made them little ducks. And God, you care about the little ducks and the birds and the trees and all kinds of critters. And most of all, you care about us, Lord. We appreciate it. Lord, thank you for what you do. In Jesus' name.